We just want to jump on here real quick and tell you that we love you guys, we miss you, and we can't wait till we get together and worship.
Hey everybody, Mike and Ronnie here. We sure do miss you all.
We can't wait till we get together again. Won't be long. We love you.
OCC, it's the Greens. We can't wait to be back with you.
Hey there, OCC. I love and I miss you guys so much, and I am counting the days until we can meet together soon.
Hey guys, Stephen family here. This is your preacher, Micah. I just want to say hello. We miss you guys. We wish we were with you, but we know we will see you very soon.
Can't wait till we get back in church together again. We see your smiling face and get to shake your hand and get the hugs. We love you.
Hey, OCC church family. I hope everybody is safe and healthy, and I miss everyone.
Hello, church family. We sure do miss you guys.
Hello. Hey, guys. Love you. Can't wait to see you.
And we just want to say that we love you guys, miss you, can't wait to see you, hug you, and just know that you're in our prayers until we see you again.
And always remember, God is faithful, and He will deliver us.
Hey! Amen. Well, welcome, church. We are glad that you are joining us from wherever you're joining us today. We just want to ask that you would just worship with us. We are just glad that we can be here. We're glad that we can come into your homes, however that may be on your TV, on your computers, on your phones. We're just glad that we can continue to worship the Lord. So we're going to ask that you guys just join with us as we continue to praise.
Moving in our midst.
working in this place. I worship you. I worship you. Working in this place. God, we come to you this morning. God, we thank you that we can come in this place and be in your spirit and worship you. We ask that you would just be with Micah as he brings the message today. God, we ask that you would just bless his words and just let his words be yours and touch someone who's watching today who needs it. We love you so much. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. It is good to see you guys online. I guess see you guys. You can see me. It's kind of intimidating for you to see me and me not be able to see you. But we're glad that you are tuning in today, that you're watching online, wherever you're at. We just, not to sound repetitive and over and over again, but we do miss you guys. And we look forward to being back with you. We've been studying through the book of Hebrews. If you have your Bibles at home, I'd encourage you to turn with me to Hebrews chapter 9. We've been going verse by verse through this entire book. It's such a deep book, but it's such a great book. And I would encourage you guys to make sure that you're following along. Maybe you missed a message at home, wherever you're at. You can catch up with those. You can go back onto our YouTube channel where you're watching right now, and you can see some of those past ones, maybe one that you missed. Also, I would say this. If you're watching with us today, let us know in the comments. I know you guys, some of you guys have some really cool pictures where you're at. Some of you still in bed, some of you not. We have people watching all over the world watching today. And so I just want to say thank you. Let us know where you're watching from this morning. Hebrews chapter 9, if you have your Bibles, we're in the middle of this series called By Faith, where we're studying through this book. And last week we went through chapter 8, which really unpacks Jesus as our high priest, right? We said he's the high priest of a new covenant, right? A better covenant for God's people that includes all Bible-believing Christians, right? Let me kind of just set it up this way for you. We kind of like to compare and contrast things. Back around the Cincinnati area, we love to compare Skyline Chili versus Gold Star Chili. Skyline Chili versus Gold Star Chili. And for me, there's a lot of people, because a lot of people do this with other things. They kind of, they're one way or the other. I'm kind of on the fence with that. I guess if I had to prefer of the two, I would say Skyline, but I like Gold Star as well. I can eat it. For you guys watching around this area, you have no idea what I'm talking about. You're like, what is he? It's gibberish. How about this one? Coke versus Pepsi. Coke versus Pepsi, right? For some people, they are die hard on one side or the other. I like them both. I have a preference. For me, it's Pepsi. And I also like the Pepsi One better than the Coke Pepsi Zero better than Coke Zero, right? I like Pepsi Zero, and they have cooler cans, which is just an added bonus. It's kind of a, anyways, whatever. How about this one? Thanksgiving versus Christmas. Before, but thanks for giving versus Christmas. You know, some people, this is why some people lose their minds over, like, if you put your Christmas tree up at the, sometime in November before Thanksgiving, people lose their minds because they're like, I can't believe you put a tree up before Thanksgiving was over. And the way I look at it is, and this is just my opinion, but the way I look at it is it makes my Thanksgiving better because I love it. And Thanksgiving versus Christmas. How about summer versus fall? Summer versus fall. That's another one. That's a big one. Those two are my favorite 2 months of the year, I believe. But I got to go with fall on that one. That's me. I'm all things fall. Candles. Make fun of me all you want. I love pumpkin. You know that. Pumpkin candles, pumpkin cheesecake, pumpkin coffee, pumpkin everything, right? In fact, I go in the fall when the fall's over and I get all those scents and stuff, and then I take them in my office. So if you ever come in my office, sometimes it smells like you walked into a fall store. That's what it's like. But anyways, for the rednecks, Ford versus Chevy, huh? Ford versus Chevy, that's a big one, right? That's a discussion. Maybe for you, you're like, neither. I like Dodge. Maybe that's what you like. I don't know. But there's those discussions that you have. The point is that we compare and we contrast almost anything that we can think of, right? And that's exactly what the author in Hebrews chapter 9 is doing. He's gonna compare and contrast the old covenant with the new covenant, right? In the first five verses, it kind of sets up this comparison. So if you have your Bibles, Hebrews chapter 9 verse 1 says this. Now, even the first covenant had regulations for worship and an earthly place of holiness for a tent. Now, the tent we talked a little bit about last week, the tent and the tabernacle are the word right there that we see here. They're interchangeable. It says this, for a tent was prepared, the first section in which were the lampstand and the table and the bread of the presence. It's called the holy place. Behind the second curtain was the second section called the most holy place, having the golden altar of incense and the ark of the covenant covered on all sides with gold, in which was a golden urn holding the manna, and Aaron's staff that budded in the tablets of the covenant. Those were the Ten Commandments. When you hear the tablets of the covenant, those are the Ten Commandments there. It says this, above it were the cherubim of glory overshadowing the mercy seat. So what we need to understand, what he's talking about here, we need to understand these verses are talking about, that very tempted right now, just kind of skip over this part. It's easy to just kind of skip over these details from the Old Testament. And why? We're in Hebrews here. We don't need to go back and talk about all the Old Testament stuff. Well, if we skip this, we'll completely miss the comparison that we have here. And what God is saying right here is that there are regulations for worship under the old covenant, right? There are regulations as to how you could worship and the way that you were supposed to worship. And this all comes out of Exodus. God said to Moses, he said, hey, I want you to build this tent, this tabernacle, right? This is the place where my presence will be. This is where you and I are going to meet. This is where I will be worshiped in this tent. Build it exactly how I'm telling you to do it. Everything that I tell you to do, everything that I want you to put in it, be sure that it's there because it's symbolic of something. It's symbolic. The golden lampstand, you saw the lampstand that was mentioned there. The golden lampstand was representative of God's light, right? God's light, it was symbolic of God revealing himself to his people, right? The bread of presence on the table that represented fellowship with God, right? Fellowship with God. This is all in the first section, right? The holy place that we just read about. There is then there was a curtain that came up after that, right? A big veil that separated the second section from the first section that we see, and that was the Holy of Holies. You've probably heard that term before. That's where the Ark of the Covenant was, right? And where God's actual presence was in the Holy of Holies, right? And this is the setup for worship. This is how it's supposed to be in the tent, in the tabernacle, right? And later it's going to be kind of in a permanent setting because Solomon, he built the temple in Jerusalem. He built it and then actually it got taken down and they built another one, right? Ezra helped build up another one. But this is how worship is set up. And God says, I want you to build this tent, this tabernacle, and I want you to come to me, right? I want you to worship me, but wait. There are going to be some restrictions first, right? There are some regulations. The first one is in verse 6. It says this, these preparations having thus been made, the priests go regularly into the first section performing their ritual duties. All right, so here's the first restriction. Not everyone can go into the place of worship, right? Only the priests were allowed to go in and perform the rituals for worship, right? The regulations for worship, to offer sacrifice. Their job was to represent the people to God. And nobody else could go in. There's more to look at. Let's look at verse 7. But into the second, and that's the Holy of Holies, that's where God's presence is, we said, right? The second section, only the high priest goes, and he but once a year. And not without taking blood, which he offers for himself and for the unintentional sins of people. So the number one restriction, not everybody gets involved. Only the priests go into the holy place. Everyone else was left out, right? Then there are three more restrictions to access God's presence. Number one, only the high priest could go into the Holy of Holies, right? That's where the buck stops after section one. Then the Holy of Holies, that's where the high priest could go. Number two, it was only one day a year, the Day of Atonement, right? We've talked about that so far in this series. And number three, he couldn't go in without the blood of the sacrifice. That was it. There was no access to God outside of this setup. No way to get to him. Let me kind of illustrate it this way. Let's say that all of us, we are all the people of God, right? This church family that we have here represents the Israelites, right? It represents the Hebrews, right? And let's just say that I'm the high priest. It means that I'm the only one, right, that in this church that gets access to God. Nobody else does, and I am the only one to have it, and I can only have it one day a year, and I have to take blood when I go in, right? What's the point of all this? I mean, why are we going through all these details? Because that's what we're here, the Hebrew author is explaining to us. He's trying to let us see that under the old covenant, there are barriers between man and God. There are barriers, right? There are things that come between us. And that's frustrating to me. Well, there's even more. Look at verse 9. According to this arrangement, gifts and sacrifices are offered that cannot, you might want to mark that word, that cannot perfect the conscience of the worshiper, but deal only with the food and the drink and various washings, regulations for the body imposed until the time of reformation. Here's what that means. The regulations for worship, the rituals, right, the sacrifices that are meant to cleanse the people of Israel are meant to make them right in God's eyes and are kind of meant to justify them. All of these regulations, right? They're meant to do all these different things, all these things, right? All of these sacrifices, all these rituals, they fall short. Think about how that would have been received by the Hebrews. So the sacrifice that they've made and the regulations for worship that they had built in their culture upon, you know, 1,500 years are just empty now. I mean, think about how that would have been received. We can't miss this, right? This would have been an earth-shattering thing for them, right? You would have been able to hear a pin drop in the room when the author is talking about this. I mean, at this point, the Hebrews people history was 2,000 years old. Well, the United States of America is 244 years old, right? Their culture, their nation, their entire life was built around and upon the old covenant. And now the author is saying, guess what? It's empty. It's empty. Doesn't matter anymore. And man, that would have rocked them. That would have rocked these people. What he's trying to do is set up the comparison of how great the new covenant is compared to the old covenant, right? He's trying to show them that the new covenant is so much better. He's trying to compare, like we talked about earlier, man. He's trying to show us why this is better than that. They thought the old covenant was really good. Now, you might have noticed that I skipped verse 8. I skipped over verse 8. It was intentional. It's because it starts with to set up why it's void. Here's what it says. By this, the Holy Spirit indicates that the way into the holy places is not yet open as long as the first section is still standing. Not yet. Those are the words. Not yet. Not yet. You ever said those words before? Not yet. Not yet. Right? Mom, Dad, is it supper time yet? Not yet. Not yet. Is it time to go outside? Not yet. Is it time for teachers? Is it time for recess? Not yet. Right? Is it the end of the day? Not yet. Are we there yet? No, we're not there yet. That really kind of sums up the entire Old Testament. Right? It means that while the tabernacle was standing, while the tent was in place, while the old covenant is in effect, while we're under the law, the true way into the Holy of Holies is shut, we can't go in. Right? It's saying that there are two major weaknesses with the old covenant. Number one, limited access to God. Right? And the second weakness is that limited sacrifices that cleanse from sin. And here's how it translates for us. Religion, it creates a false sense of access to God. And it can't save. Religion can't bring us closer. We're trying to do it in our own power. We're trying to do it on our own will. Trying to do it in our own efforts. Not letting God bring us closer to Him. What religion by law says is that I have this belief, whether I realize it or not, that somehow I can get to God and have direct access to Him based on my own efforts, right? And so I'm marking off my checklist. I'm living by this law or trying to anyways. I'm dialing up the phone, but it feels like nobody's answering on the other end. Feels like nobody was answering my call. Why won't God respond to me? Either he isn't who he says he is because he won't respond to me, or this thing is just a big joke. This whole God thing is just a big joke. And then one of two things will start to happen. We'll either try harder in our religious efforts to be better, or we'll just miss where true access to God comes from. Verse 10 says where it comes from. It says the time of reformation. Do you know what the time of reformation is? Reform means to make something into something different, right? It's the crucifixion of Jesus. At the crucifixion of the old covenant, when it ended, right, the new covenant began. Verse 11 starts to unpack this. Here's what it says. But when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things that have come, you might want to underline that, through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not of this creation, he entered once and for all into the holy places, not by the means of blood of goats and calves, check this out, but by means of his own blood, thus securing an eternal redemption. So the crucifixion, at the crucifixion of Jesus, our high priest, right? Of the new covenant, when he entered into the true Holy of Holies, the true tabernacle, which is the actual presence of God in heaven, not here on earth, that was a symbol and a shadow of what was to come, right? He entered by his own blood. Jesus entered by his own blood, paying the price that the old covenant demanded that the blood of animals could not pay for, right? It's no more, and bringing us into the new covenant. Jesus, he is the new covenant, right? The new covenant is not religion, it's not works, it's not morality, it's Jesus, and he is much better than anything else. And then verse 11, it starts to talk about the good things that have come. What are the good things that have come? That we have a secured eternal redemption. It means that for anyone who turns from the law in faith to Christ and follows him and obeys him, heaven awaits, because there are only two destinations in eternity. And that may not be very popular, that may not be politically correct, but there are only two destinations for eternity, heaven and hell, and no other options. The cross secured redemption. Paul says in Galatians chapter 3, verse 23, now before faith came, we were held captive under the law, imprisoned until the coming faith would be revealed. It's been revealed. Guess what? It's Jesus, right? And so the good things that have come, these are what we're gonna compare the old covenant to, right? The first good thing is that we have redemption in Christ. Here's the second. Remember how the old covenant, there were barriers between God and man, right? There were restrictions. Jesus, he changes all that, right? Through his sacrifice, Jesus has provided unlimited access to God the Father. And that's a good thing that's come, right? Let me kind of just try to illustrate it this way. If you're a Christian, right? If you're a Christian, if you've given your life to Christ, I want you just to stand up right where you're at your house. Some of you might have to get out of bed right now. Maybe you're on your couch. Maybe you're on your tractor watching this. I don't know. Stand up, but don't wreck your tractor if that's the case. Stand up wherever you're at. Stand up right where you're at right now, right? Don't be shy. Just stand up. Let me say this. The stand that you just made, what you guys just stood up and did, that will be the easiest stand for Christ that you'll ever have to make, right? Under the old covenant, access, you can sit down now. Access to God meant one man, one day of the year, and not without blood. But because of Jesus, it's tons of access every single day. 24/7, 365, right? You see the difference? It's a big difference. If you're in Christ, that means that you have unlimited access to Jesus, right? To talk to worship, to delight in, to enjoy right now, right? And that's a good thing that has come in Christ. I'm so thankful for that, especially in a time like we're in right now, that we have access to Jesus all the time, that He's promised to be with us, to stay with us. We have access to God, to Jesus, 24/7. Unlimited access to God, and yet often I think that a lot of us, we're not moved by that. That doesn't do anything for us. Yeah, we might say a quick prayer here and there, you know, and usually when something's wrong is when we do it. You know, if we can find time in our busy schedule, you know, we may pray, hey God, I haven't got my stimulus check yet, I need it, where's it at? You know, it might be a quick little, hey God, I need you here, I need you in this moment. We may open God's word, maybe read a chapter if we can fit it around the football game, although there are none on right now. But it's so true. We know that Jesus died for our sins, but if that's the only thing that we think Jesus accomplished on the cross, then we're selling the Son of God really short. It's like we've been given this incredible gift, right? And then just kind of put it in the closet, right? You were given a gift, but you never received it, right? It's a good thing that's come, right? We have access to God, and yet I still think that some of you, you're missing it on the other end. You're missing out on that gift that God has given us. Do you know that the temple priests, you know what they did when the veil was torn? The Bible says the veil was torn right down the middle, right? Did they fall on their knees and praise? Did they turn and they look to Jesus in faith and say, oh, my Savior, Messiah, did they do that? Did they cry out, praise God? No, they didn't do that. Instead, one of the greatest tragedies the world has ever known happened. They sewed the veil back up. Right? God Himself, He tore down that barrier that was in between them. He tore it down. The barrier that separates Him from men, and they put it back up. Barriers to God's presence are no longer from God, right? They're only from ourselves. That's the truth. So what barrier are you putting up between you and God this morning? What barrier is it that's between you? Is it guilt because of sin? You know, if that's it, if you're in Christ, then you need to understand this. Our sin does not cut our access to God. Okay? Now, it'll definitely put stress on the relationship with Him, but it won't end our access to Him. If it did, there'd be no way for us to repent and to come to the Lord for forgiveness. There's no way, right? When he promises to give us that, right? He promises us, right? So our guilt says, you know, I don't want to come to the Lord. I don't want to see Him in His holiness. I don't want Him to see me in my sin. Our guilt says things like, I'm not worthy. I'm not savable. But the problem with that is this, right? That's not what the gospel says. If that's you this morning, if that's your stance, I'm not worthy, I'm not savable, I'm too far from God, which I've heard in all the years of my ministry, I've heard that over and over and over again, then you have a really weak view of what the cross is and what the cross did. What you're saying is that the power of your sin is greater than the power of the cross. There is no sin that is greater than the power of the cross. I'm not worthy. I'm too far from God. If I step into a church, I'll be struck by lightning, right? All of that is a lie from the devil. There is no greater burden in the world than the guilt of sin. But when you feel the weight of sin, that burden, and then the blood of Christ becomes precious to you, because it's the only thing that has the power to remove that burden of guilt. It's the only thing that it promises to do so for all who come to Christ, right? Remember the old hymn we used to sing? What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole within? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. You know, following Jesus isn't always rainbows and butterflies, which so many people believe. It's hard. There's mountaintops, The highest mountaintop is baptism. That's the top of the mountain where our sins are washed away, where we surrender our life to Christ. That's the high that we're on, right? But we have to understand that there's also valleys, right? The high point is when our sins are washed away, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, we start our new journey. The Bible says we're born again, we're a new creation, right? We start our walk, but there are valleys. Those of you who've been following Christ for a long time, you know, right? Hills and valleys. That's exactly what it is. That's the walk in Christianity. So what's denying you access to God today? Are you putting up a barrier between you and God? Right? Is it a burden? Is it a feeling of unworthiness or a feeling of dirtiness? You know, Colossians chapter 2, verse 13, Paul says this. He says, and you, let me say that again, and you, right? And you who were dead in your trespasses and uncircumcision of your flesh, God made alive together with him, having forgiven us all our trespasses by canceling the record of debt that stood against us with its legal demands. This he set aside, nailing it to the cross. So our debt has been paid, right? Our sin has been nailed to the cross. Jesus, he has removed the burden of sin. He's removed that guilt. That veil has been torn down, right? Don't sew it back up. Don't sew it back up. I don't know how many of you know how to sew, but don't sew that veil back up. I have a feeling that some of us are better sewers than we thought. Some people are sewing that veil back up right now. Here's a snapshot of the two covenants, right? Here, let me just give you a basic image of both, and you can kind of determine which one you like better. The old covenant restricted access to God in a system that cannot wash or cleanse sin. New covenant, unlimited access to God, unlimited access to Jesus, and your sin is washed away. And oh, by the way, heaven, it's a great place. I'm looking forward to it. Maybe you've heard of it, right? When you're looking at the two like that, I think the new covenant wins hands down. And that's like comparing Papa John's with Little Caesars. I don't know how many people like Little Caesars, but you're crazy if you like it, right? I know it's $5. I know it's cheap. It's $5 for a reason, right? Papa John's. And the same with Pizza Hut. Get out of here with Pizza Hut, man. I used to love Pizza Hut when I was younger. I would go after a baseball game or whatever. Man, Pizza Hut, man, it's too greasy and gross. I mean, give me Papa John's. Anyways, talking about food, I'm hungry. Can you tell? All right, the old covenant, it's been outdated for 2,000 years. But when these two comparisons were made, when the book of Hebrews was originally written, comparing these two would have probably hit close to home for some, right? Probably too close for some people, right? Now, there's no one here who's experienced animal sacrifices under the old covenant. If you have, I'm sure it was illegal, and I'm probably never going to let you walk my dog, okay? But many of us, we still make ourselves live under the law of religion, right? If you're Jewish or if you have a Jewish background, there's no more temple or tabernacle, right, where the sacrifices of this law take place. It doesn't exist anymore. It hasn't since 70 AD, right? So comparing the old covenant to the new covenant, I think it loses a little bit of the impact on us, right, that it would have maybe had on the Hebrew people. Because none of us had any experience with that. C.S. Lewis is a fantastic author, right? If you don't know who he was, he was the author of The Chronicles of Narnia. That's probably his most famous one. The Screwtape Letters was a great book as well. But those of you who don't read, probably Chronicles of Narnia is your best bet because they made a movie out of it, right? But he was a professor at Oxford as well. And one day he was confronted by some of his colleagues about his faith. And they asked him to come into the classroom with them. And so he does. And when he got in there, there was a chalkboard. And written on this chalkboard were many different religions. And Christianity was written right in the middle of it. And they said to him, what's the difference between Christianity and all these world religions? And they thought that they were going to have him stumped. They thought C.S. Lewis was stumped, and in their mind, there was no difference. All religion was the same to them. And so Lewis looked at them, at the board, and he looked at them and he responded and he said, well, that's easy. The difference between Christianity and these world religions, he said, the difference is grace. That's the difference. Every world religion requires man reaching up to God. Right? Christianity requires man's faith, God reaching down to man. Right? So let's just do a quick comparison really quick. I can look at some world religions, just comparing them. Some of the big ones. Hinduism. It's a big one. Hinduism says that there is not one God, but there are 3.3 million gods, right? It says that you must listen to internal law. The more bad deeds you perform, the more good deeds that you need to perform to pay them off, right? It's called, you've probably heard this before, people use it all the time, it's called karma, right? You've probably heard that before. It says that it's an illusion to know God, that everyone must pay off their own debt, right? There's no grace. There's no forgiveness. That sounds a little bit different, doesn't it? Live a good life, and then one day you can kind of just stop existing as a human, right? It may take multiple reincarnations for this to happen, but the end goal is to not exist. Well, Jesus says, in comparison, Jesus says you can't pay off your debt because I've already paid it for you, right? I've already paid it. Here is forgiveness, not because of what you've done, but because of what I've done, because I created you to exist with me for eternity. Eternal life isn't a curse, it's a blessing. It's a blessing. Let's move on to the next one, Buddhism, right? Buddhism is really kind of a break off of Hinduism. It says that there is no one God to be worshipped, that everyone must listen to this internal law that you follow, four principal truths. And if you live in an eight-step life, one day, maybe in this life or maybe in the next life, you can experience enlightenment, which they call nirvana, right? It's not just a band, okay? It's part of a religion, right? This comes from Buddhism. Nirvana, that's the goal. It says that knowing God is an illusion, right? You must achieve, and there are multiple paths to enlightenment, that everyone must find their own path. Basically, it boils down to this, Buddhism, right? Live a good life, achieve, and you can cease to exist. That's what it boils down to, right? But Jesus says this. He says, you can't achieve salvation. He says, I've already achieved it for you. There aren't multiple paths. I'm the path. I'm the guide. I'm the map, right? I'm the GPS. Follow me because I love you. And not only can you know him personally and intimately, but that's actually God's desire. He wants you to know him personally, intimately. And that's why he gave us his word, what we're studying today, right? That's why we have the Bible. Let's move on to another big one, Islam, right? Islam says that you cannot know God and that having a personal relationship with God does not exist, that you must achieve also, right? It says to listen and submit to the five pillars of Islam and then you can achieve salvation. It's based upon works. Salvation then becomes subjective because on the day of judgment, Allah, depending on what mood he's in, it maybe just depends, right? Whatever mood he's in can either revoke or grant salvation, all based upon works. Jesus says, I'm God. You can know me. You can have a personal relationship with God the Father because God is a personal God. And not only does God interact with man, but he takes it to the next level. He sacrificed himself so that we could engage with him. We could have a personal relationship with him. We could enjoy him. We could delight in him, right? Maybe comparing Jesus to other world religions, maybe that doesn't hit very close to home for us, right? Because we're in Odin, Indiana, right? We don't have a whole lot of experience with other world religions. And I know some of you may do, I don't know, but most of us don't. Most of us don't know a Hindu or a Buddhist or a Muslim, right? Well, what about humanism? This one might hit closer to us. Humanism says that man is the measure of all things, not God. Humanism says that people are the source of truth and people are the pursuit and the goal in life and people are the solution to the world's problems. But Bible-believing Christians, they think that God of the Bible is the measure of all things, that He is the source of truth, that He is the pursuit, and He is the goal of life. Christians believe that man isn't the source of the solution, but man is actually part of the problem, right? Because of man's sin, the world is broken. It's filled with problems, and it will be until Jesus comes back and makes all things new. Jesus is the solution. Humanism boils down to this. Man is his own God. And I don't know about you, but I make a terrible God. I've tried, and I've crashed, and I've burned. I've just done an awful job when I've tried to make myself a God, right? What about tolerance? Tolerance has really become a popular thing, a religion in our culture that must be worshipped and followed. Have you ever noticed this? So tolerance sounds like something like this. To each his own, no judgment, no judgment. Truth is whatever true is to you, right? Be open-minded. It's this idea that man is free to believe whatever he wants to believe as an individual, to do whatever he wants to do, because the goal in life is man's happiness, right? Which is actually very, very humanistic, right? And maybe you've heard that Christians are intolerant. Maybe you've heard that before. You can watch it. You can probably pull up some stuff right now on Google that Christians are intolerant. You ever heard this before? Maybe someone said it to you. Usually what happens is that Christians are criticized for their beliefs as being intolerant. But isn't that in and of itself intolerance? Right? Isn't that a contradiction? And so usually what happens is that someone is waving this flag of tolerance, right? Hey, tolerant, right? No judgment here. And they're criticizing me for what I believe, but aren't they being intolerant of my beliefs? See, Jesus, he is incredibly tolerant. Don't get me wrong. He'd have to be in order to die for us. God is a God of love. God is a God of grace. Here's the thing that people tend to misunderstand. Both Christians and non-Christians misunderstand this. God does not tolerate sin. He doesn't, right? It's okay to come to Christ exactly as you are, wherever you're at, whatever you've done, whatever you're in, but it's not okay to stay that way. Because once you're in Christ, you're a new person. You're different, right? True conversion results in a changed heart, right? You'll begin to love what God loves, and you'll begin to hate what God hates, right? God loves people, but he hates sin. He does. And here's the problem. Here's where we've made this mistake in our culture. We attach someone's sin to their identity. And God, he doesn't do that. If God attached someone's sin to their identity, then he would hate them, right? But we see throughout Scripture that he doesn't. God loves people, but he hates sin. And here's what that means for us as Christians. It means that sometimes tolerance is not loving. It's actually the most hateful thing that you can do. Right? I know that sin leads down this path of destruction and death. If I'm just going to stand back and hold the flag of tolerance, I'm not loving that person. I'm actually hating that person because I'm not telling them the actual truth in which they need to go, the path in which God has for them. What it means for Christians is that we are called to love everyone, right? Our brothers and our sisters in Christ and those who are outside of Christ, we're called to love everyone. We don't attack people who are outside of Christ for their sin. We point them to Jesus. That's what we do. We don't smash them in the head with the Bible. No, we give it to them as the message of hope. And that's what people, so many people need. I saw an article the other day, because of the coronavirus, Bible sales have went way up. People are buying their Bible. They need hope. And that's what we're supposed to do, is give it to them. Yes, we're supposed to speak loud and of God boldly and unapologetically, right? We're not supposed to skip over the tough parts. And some people don't like to even hear what I'm saying right now. But we're not called to water it down. We don't water down the message to make it fit our lives, right? But we speak this boldly and unapologetically with grace and truth. Peter says respect and gentleness when we talk to people. If grace and love are not married to boldness and truth, well, there's going to be bad effects on either side of the fence. And here's how people are one to Christ. They hear the power of the gospel and the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ in love, and then they see its power in itself. They see it in you. They see you and how the gospel has changed your life. Now, I understand that some things that I've just said may sound a little bit arrogant to you. That might be a little bit arrogant. I understand that. I knew what I was going to say when I was thinking of this, but don't make this mistake for arrogance. These aren't my words. They're God's. I'm just a messenger. Right? Jesus says in John chapter 14, verse 6, I am the way. That's singular, not plural. I am the way, the truth. That's singular. The life, singular. And nobody comes to the Father but by me. Singular. Right? And what that means is that there are not multiple worldviews. Right? They're not. There's only two. There's Jesus and there's a lie. There's Jesus and everything else. World religions, culture. Ideologies, false gospels, they're all a false God. They're false doctrine. And Jesus, he is so much better than a lie. He's so much better than a lie, right? But the obvious question is how? If you're going to make a bold statement like I just made, how is Jesus better? Well, I'm glad that verse 13 explains that for me. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? So here's the answer. The answer is his blood. That's the answer. The blood of Christ, it is superior, right? It's superior to the blood of animals, right? In the old covenant, it's superior to religions, to all of our own efforts into reaching God. We trust in Christ's blood. It's his blood. Nothing but the blood, right? The blood of Christ has power. It has power, right? Verse 13 says that it purifies from dead works. That means that religion, it doesn't remove sin. Man doesn't remove sin. Only the power of Jesus' blood can remove sin. The blood of Jesus also, though, it gives us purpose. Verse 14 gives us that purpose. It says to serve the living God. And that's a question that's been asked for centuries, right? What is the meaning of life? What's the purpose of life? Verse 14, to serve the living God. Charles Spurgeon, he gives a great explanation of this. Let me just read it like this because I can't give it any better than he can. It says this, it says, to serve the living God is necessary to the happiness of a living man. For this end we were made. And we miss the design of our making if we do not honor our Maker. Man's chief end is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. If we miss that end, we are ourselves terrible losers. The service of God is the element in which alone we can fully live. Our purpose is to serve God. Not as meaningless slaves, but as what we were designed to do with our greatest joy in mind, His greatest glory, serving the living God. It's not just this mundane requirement. It is a privilege that we're able to serve Him. It is a privilege to be able to help others in serving God. Verse 15, this is going to be the answer to another question that's asked a lot of times. Therefore, He is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from the transgressions committed under the first covenant. For where a will is involved, the death of the one who made it must be established. For a will takes effect only at death, since it is not in force as long as the one who made it is alive. Therefore, not even the first covenant was inaugurated without blood. Jump down to verse 22. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood. And without the shedding of blood, here it is, there is no forgiveness of sins. So here's the question that's asked. Why did Jesus have to die? We just talked about that a little bit last week. So we celebrated the resurrection of Jesus. Your kids might have asked it. They may be asking right now. I don't know. Maybe that's the first time you've heard that question. I don't know. Yeah, maybe that's a great question, right? Forgiveness of sins. Verse 22 says that there is no forgiveness of sins without the shedding of blood. If Jesus didn't die on the cross, you and I, no forgiveness. None. No grace. And that sounds a little harsh, doesn't it? It doesn't sound very good. I don't like that. Why is death a requirement for forgiveness? And here's the thing. God didn't make it a requirement. We did. We made it that way. It goes all the way back to Genesis chapter 3. God told Adam, remember, in the garden, he says, don't eat of this tree. And what that means is that sin and death, they were attached. They were brought together. They can't be separated by us, right? So when man chose to bring sin into the world, he chose to bring death into the world as well. And now those two things, they can't be separated. There's no forgiveness outside of death. And the problem is your death, my death, not powerful enough to grant forgiveness. It's not. Only Jesus can do that. Only Jesus. But the second reason in verse 15, we have a promised eternal inheritance. If you're in Christ, you're a beneficiary of that will. Right? If you're holding on, you're not fading away. The Bible says that no one can imagine what God has planned for those who love Him. So here's what we know. If you're a Christian, all we know is that it's going to be awesome. If you're being faithful and you're holding on to Him and not letting go, heaven's going to be an awesome place. It's going to be awesome. Heaven is a wonderful place filled with glory and grace. Let's try to wrap this up. Verse 24 says this, for Christ has entered not into holy places made with hands, which are copies of the true things, but into heaven itself, now to appear in the presence of God on our behalf. He's our high priest, we said. Nor was it to offer himself repeatedly as the high priest enters the holy places every year with blood, not his own, for then he would have had to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world. But as it is, he has appeared once and for all at the end of ages to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after comes judgment. So Christ, having been offered once to bear the sins of many, will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, but to save those who are eagerly awaiting Him. So the work is done. Jesus is our high priest. He's the high priest of the new covenant. He has secured our eternal redemption. He has given us access to God. We have a promised eternal inheritance waiting on us. And here's the question. Are you under the old covenant or the new covenant? If you're under the old covenant, meaning you're still trusting in the law, you're still trusting in your religion, you're still, maybe it's just unbelief altogether, then you're still dead in your sin and you're under the law, not under grace. There's a reason that verse 24 says that man dies and then comes judgment, right? Now, that's one of the warnings that we see in Hebrews. It's a warning Because if you're under the law, if you're under the old covenant, if you're under some sort of unbelief, maybe you just don't believe at all, the warning is that some of you, if you were to die, you have seen your last days. And for some of you, death may come today. It's not a scare tactic, it's just real. We know that, you know that. Whenever it does come, if you're under the old covenant, if you're outside of Christ, there is no more grace. It's only judgment. The whole point the author of Hebrews is trying to make is that if you don't move from the old covenant to the new covenant, from religion with Jesus to a relationship with Jesus, from unbelief to faith in Christ, well, then the results are no salvation. And that's not a popular thing to say. I realize that. It leads to death. But then in verse 28, it says Jesus, he's coming back a second time, not to deal with sin. He's already dealt with that. But when he comes back, he's coming to save those who are, keyword, eagerly awaiting him. So as we wrap this up today and we're coming to an end of this message, the question is this for you. Are you eagerly awaiting the return of Christ? Paul says in Philippians 1 that to live is Christ and to die is gain. It's much better for Christians after death, right? Eagerness for the return of Christ is a characteristic of all true believers. To be ready, to be eager, to be aware. Are you eagerly awaiting Jesus' return? I know I am. I look at this world around me, and the more I see of its imperfections and its brokenness, I can't wait to be with Jesus. Some of you guys are still trying to save yourself. But let me say this. The blood of Jesus has power. It gives purpose to everyone who will be washed by it. I'll never forget, I used to sing that song all the time, man. Some of you guys, you remember maybe growing up, if you grew up in church, I remember sitting on those blue pews and we'd sing that song. My grandmother was on the organ. My mama was on the piano. Right? Dennis Smith was rocking the bass, man. He was doing the little, the bass that he was on the bass. Different guy, man. We had the whole. They'd play that song. What can wash away the power of the blood, man? The blood is a powerful thing. Jesus, he died for you. Jesus has given you access to God. You don't have to go through a high priest other than Jesus. You have to go in this Holy of Holies. He's everywhere. Jesus has prepared a place for you. He's calling you. So here's my thing to you. It's your move. Ball's in your court. What are you waiting on? If you haven't given your life to Christ, let me say it as I say it every week, because I think it's so important. It can change. Life can change like that. There's only one way to Jesus, or to God, and it's through Jesus. He's our bridge. He's our mediator. He's our connector. He built that bridge to connect us back to God. There's only one way. It's not all roads. It's one. Right? So because of that, do you believe that? Do you believe that Jesus is the Christ? Do you believe that he wasn't a liar, he wasn't a lunatic, but he's Lord? That he came here to die on a cross, which we celebrated last week. We celebrated, should celebrate it every single day of our lives. We remember what he did for us on the cross. Then to repent of our ways, to repent of our lifestyle and change the way that we are. Change who we used to be. We're not living that way anymore. There's a change that must take place. We're crossing over from the old life to the new life. It's not I'm sorry and living my old life. It's changing, right? and then to confess with our mouth that Jesus is Lord. That no matter what happens to me, no matter what anybody is around me, it doesn't matter who puts me in, if I'm the only one that's still standing, could you say those words? Jesus is Lord. And then to be baptized for the forgiveness of your sins. Oh, what an amazing thing to enter into the waters of baptism and to have your sins washed away, because that's where we're coming in contact with the blood of Jesus Christ. That's where the power is. And then to receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, that's where we said the mountaintop, and that's where the journey starts. And then to hold on to that anchor, not to drift away, but to remain faithful. So I'm going to pray for you today. I don't know what you're going through. Some of you are lonely today. Some of you may be experiencing things like depression. Maybe you already have, and COVID-19 thing, man, is just really, really hard on you. And I'm just going to pray for you here in just a minute, because I believe prayer is a powerful thing. I believe lives are being changed through this because of what God is doing. I believe that God is the one that's doing the healing, not us. We're just here lifting up our prayers to Him. And God hears our prayers. I don't know, there's some people that maybe haven't given their life to Christ. I pray that they would follow the Bible, the biblical plan of salvation, which I just gave. I would love to see people cross over from death to life. People are doing that this morning all over the place. If that's you, I don't care if coronavirus or COVID-19 is going on right now. I will meet you. I will make sure that it gets taken care of, and do it now. Today, it's urgent. For those of you who've already done that, you've already crossed over, let me encourage you. Some of you are drifting. You're drifting away. Don't drift away. Hold on to the anchor. Hold on tight, because He's the only way. So I'm going to pray for you right now, and I'm just going to let God move. I'm going to let Him do the convicting. There's nothing I can do to make that happen. It's all Him. The Bible says in Acts chapter 2, when they heard that message, it convicted them. It cut them to the heart. God, we come to You this morning. There's some people who are living. They're living in their own efforts. They're living in their own desires. They're living in a life that is outside of You. And I pray, God, this morning that if there is someone who hasn't truly given their life to You for the right reasons, or maybe they haven't done it the right way that You've told us to do in Your Word, God, that they would just own up to it and say, I haven't done it. I need to do it, because life's not promised. God, I pray for those this morning who have done that. But for whatever reason, they've drifted into the world. They've let the world change them and them not change the world. And I just pray, God, that they would come back. They would realize that they're falling away. Maybe they're mad at God, or maybe they're mad at You. They're mad at something, maybe someone else. And they're using it for some way to, almost like an excuse, God. I just pray this morning that You'd let them know You love them, and you're still waiting for them with Your arms open, waiting for them to come back. They just humble themselves and find their way back to the anchor and hold on. God, I pray for our world right now that is hurting. God, we've seen You move. We've seen You move mountains. And we believe You're going to do it again. God, it feels like right now we are so up in the air about what's going to happen, and how many people are going to die, and when are we going to be able to leave our houses, and when are we going to be able to get back to normal. And I know, God, that You're doing something through this. I know You're doing something in our world. You're doing something in our country. You're doing something in our state. You're moving in our community. You're moving in our church right now. I know it. I can feel it, because I know, God, You're in control. You've never stopped being in control. And God, we know that You're going to do it again. So I pray this morning, morning. I'm going to leave it right here. God, I pray this morning that you would move in their lives and in some way convict them to follow you with everything they got. God, we love you. We praise you. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
come to you today. We thank you so much, God, that we can stand right here today and we can pronounce that you have done it and you're going to do it again. God, we know that we live uncertain times, Father God, but we've seen you move mountains and we know that you can do it again. We love you so much today and we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. You guys have an awesome week and we will see you next week.